Hey everybody, how you doing? It's Phil with Behringer. Welcome to Music Studios. I want to talk to you today. This is kind of like an extra performance of a broadcast we did the other day. And so we're going to go over a lot of the same topics. And today's topic is the X-Touch working with the XR18 and with the XAir products. There's a new software update for the X-Touch, which is 1.15. And of course, you can download all your updates and everything right at Behringer.com free. And so there's a new update here that is just amazing. And it's got a lot of great features. And let's go through them. The topic of today, this is an overview live broadcast. So be sure to put in your questions and I'll field questions and things like that throughout the event. And it's so cool, all the new features. So I want to get them to you because even when I got the update, I was like, okay, this is really cool. All right, so let's just jump in. Now, let's just talk about the basics, okay, about how to connect everything, or at least how I'm connected, because I want to have like a real world scenario, okay? So if you watched the broadcast the other day, this is a lot of the same information, but just more clear this time. And so my basic setup is I brought out a router, okay? And so the XAir products have a router built into them, but in this scenario being like, okay, if I was on a gig and I had to have, if I was using the X-Touch for front of house, I'd either have to have a router back by the XAir or I'd have to have a router up here and at front of house position. And for this particular setup, which is the X-Touch and a laptop, you know, because I'm actually controlling a DAW at the same time, which is hip, with Mackie control, okay, and two other units, okay? So if we get to look over, I also have the capability to be able to use an iPad or an Android device, and I can have up to five devices at the same time. So you'll see if I move this fader here, you see it move on the iPad, and what's even fun is you'll see it move. And if I move on the X-Touch, then it's gonna go ahead and it'll be visible everywhere and you can see it in the software and things like that. So these are all on the same network that I made with this router. So I'm physically connected to the router with the X-Touch, okay? And then from there out, everybody else is connected to that network, okay? And then they all lap together. Now, in addition to that, there's a couple cables coming out of the back here, and one is actually just USB going from this to my XR18, and then in addition, I've got it going also up because there's dual ports on the X-Touch, which is hip, dual USB ports. I'm also going up to the laptop. So the reason for this is just imagine in like in a real world situation, I have a band on stage, I'm tracking the band, or I'm even in the band and it would be kind of hip to have this on stage, you know? And I want to record the show, okay? So as you know, with the XR18, I can take all the channels out of that and go to a DAW. So that's what the USB is for there, to pass information back and forth. Also, if I wanted to have a show where I was doing a production show and I was like, I had some production tracks that I wanted to play back, like I had stems from a record or something like that that I wanted to have come back, I could bring those back from the laptop into my mix here and also have it play along with the live performance. So those kind of features we already kind of knew were in place, and it's about how to control those things. So with the new software version of the X-Touch, the 1.15, it makes it so cool to do that. So the way I'm going to kind of go through this is that right now on the X-Touch, the use of it is like the rotary encoders are a big part of this, how it goes on. I'm going to put it in track mode. And the rotary encoders are really important, and these buttons. So the way I'm going to talk about this unit and direct us through it is to talk about the rotary encoders and these first six buttons at the top, okay, my encoder assign buttons. And then we're going to talk about some of the function buttons and what they do, and then we're going to talk about the modify, automation, utility buttons and what functions they have to control it, and then of course the transport section. So this is just kind of methodology of how we're going to go through the unit. So let's just dive in. The first button up here is track. And as you can see with the track stuff, I have my track information. This is my select button for the track, all those things happen. And you're seeing LED movement because I do have a session playing out of Logic, and I'll show that in a little bit. But up here on the scribble strip, you can see right away I can control my gain. And if you can see also, if we take a look at the computer screen, you'll see that my gain is moving up and down as well. So I can see, move that back and forth. And then also, if I go ahead and I want to choose which way I want to have an input going, I can sit here and move this, and I can choose between whether I want to have, like if I want to assign a different input, I can choose that just by pressing and holding on a button. on the rotary encoder there, okay? And then this button is in this mode. It's not an actual record button. What it is it lets me choose between analog input and USB input, okay? So I can do that. Now, what's even more fun is if I'm in the analog input mode, I might be using a dynamic microphone or I might be using a condenser microphone. If I'm using a condenser microphone, if I press and hold on the rotary encoder, you'll see that P shows up there, and on the track, you'll see that the 48 volts is lit, okay? So I can assign phantom power to a particular input just by pressing and holding on the rotary encoder and then hitting the record button. So that's a super easy way to be able to connect a mic, set the gain for it, and get on your show, okay? And then I'm gonna go ahead and head back to USB land because I have some tracks being back. So this is as easy as it is to just get mic levels and or USB levels dialed in on your track. Now, I'm looking at the global view of the software here, of the X-Air software, the X-Edit software, which is another free download from the website, from Behringer.com. Okay, so for each of these tracks, you can go ahead and see what's happening and what's going on in the area as I go to it. So let's take a look back at the X-Touch right quick, and we'll go through the rest of the buttons. So the first one, like I said, is the gains and things like that. Now, the second one, the pan, is exactly what it says. You know, you see the pan going on channel one down there, you'll see the pan going back and forth, and channel two, channel three. And what's nice is if I get over here and I go, yeah, really, that's kind of wrong. Let me get back started where I was. You just click on the rotary encoder for that channel, and it goes back to zero, goes back to center. So if you ever start having any panning issues or things going on, you go, let me just start back at zero. You just press the encoder, and you're good to go. Okay, so that's basically what the pan surround does. Now, the EQ, this is where the scribble strips start getting really fun, okay? Because you'll notice on the EQ one now, I have 1/2. That means that there are more than one page that's going on, okay? So I can look here and see what's going on, and then up on the software page, if I go to the EQ section, okay, of channel one, you can see the screen that's there. Now, if we can take a look also at both screens again, both of them together, then you can see if I move this knob for channel one, you can see that I'm changing the gain, -7, -5, into the plus here, of that particular frequency of 148.3. Now if I press and hold it, I can change the frequency. So this is how easy it is to control my EQ right from here. Now the next question is, how do I get to the Q of it, or the width of how much frequency I want to? I go to here and go to page two, and now you'll see that I can make it basically a notch filter, or I can make a broadband either way. So this is what's kind of fun about the EQ, is if I'm on page one, I can choose the EQ band and what do I want to affect with it. And also over here is my high pass filter, so I can start that right away and decide the frequency, the low frequency where my cutoff is. And then so this is how easy it is to choose my EQ. And you'll notice that this rotary encoder right here, the number two encoder, is going to be pretty much the one where you go to different pages when you have things going on. So this is the EQ section. Now, for more fun, we go to the send page, okay? So if we go here and I go to my sends, now these rotary encoders, you see it's bus one through bus six, okay? And the rotary encoders, and you'll see here that it's actually controlling my buses that are going out. So you can see on the screen, I'm moving a bus up and down. So this is bus one for channel one. You see it says Vox one in the upper left of the screen. And so then this is my bus sends. So if these were monitor mixes, I could be sending, oh, I need more, a little bit more vocal one, or a little less vocal one, and monitor three, monitor four, let's bring it up, blah, 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 and we do this, send it down. Now, this is kind of cool for doing exact science kind of work on a mix, but there's an easier way to be able to do this across the board as well, and I'll show you that in just a second. So this is the send button that's doing this. Now if I go to the plugin button, it's the same exact thing, but now for my effects sends. So now it's the effects sends. So for whatever track I wanted to do, I'm just doing the example was track one, and you would just hit the select button for the track you wanted to do here, okay? But then for this, I can control my effects sends, how much I want to have it to a reverb or something like that. So it's pretty hip that way, okay? So this is how to control your sends and your effects sends from in a particular channel at any time, just by hitting the send or the plugin button. So it's super cool to be able to do this. Now the instrument button, this is going to the next part, and it's kind of really hip because now it's set up, I can adjust things that are going on with particular effects in it. So you can see I'm on my channel one effects page for the gate. and gates, compressors, and EQs are on every channel on the XR, as you know. So this is how I control the gate, and you can see it has three pages. So I go through all the usual suspect things that you would use to adjust a compressor with, the threshold, the mode, and it shows whether you want to be a gate or a ducker or something like that. So I can choose the mode that I want to have for it. I want to stay on gate. And then the range of it that I want to have to be able to affect it with. And then, of course, the important things, the attack, hold, and release times. Okay, I can adjust those here as well. Okay, so that's all those parameters just for the front page of the gate. Now, if I go to page two, look at this. All of a sudden, I'm able to go to my compressor. And all the same features are here for my compressor. The threshold for the compressor, ratio, things like that. Gain, attack, whole nine yards. Okay, so all these features are there. And if I turn this button, if I press this, that turns the compressor on and off. So if you want to A-B it against something, then you go, is that working? Okay, it's not compressed now. Okay, that sounds about right. Okay, cool. So that's first page is EQ, or I'm sorry, the first page is gate. The second page is compressor. Okay, and then the third page is I can go ahead and set up a channel for auto mix if I wanted to for the assigning the XY of a particular channel. And you can see for channel one, right now for the Dugan style auto mix, you see the Y popping up there, and I can choose to do that and assign it a channel if I wanted to and the weight for that. And so there's X or Y. So I can do that. So that's really hip. So on just for the instrument button, I have being able to set up the Dugan style auto mix, or I can do the compressor settings, or I can do the gate settings. So just in these six buttons, you have a lot of control going on in the unit. So that's a lot of the fun part of it, is being able to control so many different things with just this top six. I mean, it's gonna get your mix happening in a great way. Okay, so let's just go ahead and move down to the bottom right of the X-Touch, so where we can actually explain a couple things with the function buttons and things like that here. Because these buttons right here, the global view and these do not have anything assigned at this point in time. So I'm not even going to go through these because there's no point. There's nothing assigned there. Okay, so but the function buttons do have some really cool things, and these are dealing with your effects. So let's go ahead and just take a peek. As soon as I hit function one, now the rotary encoder is choosing between my different effects, okay? So I can go here and say, okay, this is my reverb delay, and the things like that. And I'll show you on the computer what that means. So if I'm looking at, like, I have a vintage room reverb, right? And so I'm looking at this, and you can see that it's changing. If I go here to page one, right? And then I go to this first encoder, you can see the numbers are changing. I'm going through my reverb delay, I'm going through these things, the size, and I can adjust all these features for it. And it's nice to have this capability to adjust my reverb, the room size and things like that right away, so I can make it match the environment that I want to actually mix in or create a new environment, which is what a reverb's for. All right? So then if I go to the next one, the next function button, you notice this changed to hall. Well, if you notice on the screen there, that's what I have next is my hall reverb, okay? And I have pages for that. And for this one, it's the stereo delay. So it's just following through the EQ or the effects path, so I can adjust all of my effects, okay? And then F5 and F6 are not assigned right now. And then F7, if you'll notice on the auto mix on the screen, on the X Edit app, I can choose to turn on and off my X Edit for my Dugan style auto mix. So that's really handy to have between the F7 and F8. So just on these sets of buttons, I have total control of all of the parameters of my effects. So it's nice to have that kind of capability. And if I just hit the track button, I'm back up to my top settings again. So it's really nice to be able to, as you can see, this software update takes total control of the XR18 and makes it super simple for you to use, whether you're doing a live gig and setting it up that way, or whether you're actually mixing a record, you know, taking audio back from a DAW back into it. And that's what I kind of want to get to in just a little bit. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to talk about the modify automation and utility buttons, and they take over. Remember I told you earlier that you can do the sends, and you can actually have that and use the rotary encoders to be able to say, okay, this should go to the monitor, blah, blah, blah. Now, let's take a look at a super easy way to do this with effects and with the sends using these modify buttons. So let's just jump back in. If I hit the modify number one button, okay, you see that these are the channel sends for the effects. Okay, so if I go to the app and I go here to effects one, you can see that the faders are affecting. So this is all of my channels. Instead of like with the rotary encoders, I was taking one channel to it. It's like now I can go ahead and have all my sends go there. So this is my effect send to effect one. You see I have effect one selected here on the screen. And if I wanted to go to effects two and look there, and then now hit this button, which is the option button, if I hit that one, then I go ahead and that's effects two. Then control is here, number three. And so what ends up happening is I can go ahead and move these around to assign to what I want to, okay? And then in the software, you can see that like right now I'm on effects three. Okay, cool. And we can go and we can move these here. So if we can take the screen cut of the X-Air Edit app and move it to the upper left here, I'll show the rest of the channels over here, the rest of the buttons for automation. Awesome. What a production team I got here, right? They're knocking it out. I love this. So it's AJ in the house. Okay, so now I go to the automation buttons, right? And so the first ones I was pressing was the modifier for effects 1, 2, 3, and 4. For the automation, these are my sends, okay? So now if I hit the automation button for number 1 and I go to bus 1, now instead of assigning them like I did with the rotary encoders, one channel at a time, now I have all my channels. So these are everything that's going to my first output, my send. So this could be a wedge on the front of stage, and I can say, yeah, I need a bit of all these kids in the front wedge. And then I go ahead and go to the next one, and now you can see that the condition has changed, and I go to bus two here, and you can see that I can move some of these up. And so it's cool, because the first one that I showed is by channel with the rotary encoders, and this one is by send. Okay, so this makes it super simple to set up a monitor mix live on the show. So this is send 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Okay, is how that works. Okay, and then over here I've got just control buttons for doing the sends and the saves and things of that nature. And if there was in normal mode here, it actually controls my mute groups. You can see in the bottom toward right of the software, you see one flashing on and off, 2, 3, and 4. Okay, so these are my mute groups here. So this is super simple just with these buttons to control all of your sends for your effects and to control all of your sends for your monitor wedges and or in-ears, because you could assign these outputs because you do have the Ultranet on the XR18 so that you could hook it up to a P16M, which is our unit for setting in-ear mixes or a close monitor wedge, a powered monitor wedge mix. And it's super simple to be able to just kind of go, yeah, I'm dialing in my in-ears and I can correct my own mix, and which makes it nice for the front of house engineer, because then if your in-ears, if they sound bad or your monitor wedge sounds bad, you did it. So you finally have total freedom of your own monitors and be able to dial it in yourself. So even while the front of house person is sitting here with this, you can be on your iPad here or with your Droid, something like that, and dial in your own mixes on stage in real time. How cool is that? It's really cool. Okay, so now this is kind of what's going on with the X-Touch and with the Droid and interfaces using these and how to get around this, which is crazy cool to be able to edit. At the same time, there's different modes when I boot up. Okay, if I boot up the machine and I say, okay, I want to just control it, it'll say external control is one option, and that is just using the X-Touch, okay, with the XR18. Now the next mode is going to say external control MC for Mackie control. The next one is external control Huey for Huey control. And so it's really hip to be able to control a DAW with the X-Touch at the same time that you're controlling the XR18. So it's a really, you know, the setup to control both of those things and to make sure that they're all working really well together is it's yeah, I just did it. It's just one button push. If I go back between the Sempty and Beats button, this is controlling the X-Air, the XR18, and now I'm controlling the track in Logic. So if I scroll over here, you can see I have a live session going on in Logic on the computer, and I'm actually controlling my faders and things like that right in Logic, okay? And if I go back here and I go back to my software here, now I'm controlling everything, and I go back to my main mix, then you can see I have fader control over here as well in my track mode. You can see I have fader control. So here I'm in the DAW, and here I'm in the X, you know, so I can just go back and forth, and it's super simple. So we get down to the transport here, and the transport works for my DAW. I can go back and forth with the jog wheel. I can, you know, play, I can put it in record, I can do rewind if I want to. All the transport wheels controls work wonderful. At the same time, you notice that I'm actually being able to go back and forth and control the XR18 as well. So this is a lot of control for being able to control things both in the XR18 world and in your DAW, which is really nice to have all in one unit that actually takes care of both and makes your life. You always hear me talk about the flow of things, okay? Well, it doesn't get any easier than this now. You know what I mean? If I want to control both live or in the studio, this is the controller now. It takes care of everything, and you still have the control to be able to do it with your iPad and your Android, or you can do it right off the laptop as well. So this is just a quick overview of everything that's going on here. So what we're going to do is we're going to take just a little bit of a short break and show a little other video of some things we've actually recorded with the XR18, which is cool. And then I'm going to go ahead and drop in your questions if you want, and I'll be able to read them here and see if we have any stuff that's coming up, and I'll be glad to answer questions for you. So we'll be back in just a few minutes. Thanks a lot. Welcome back. Here we are, and I do have some cool questions from some of you that are watching, and I invite more of you to jump in and hit us up with questions. Michael Wood, he asked if the XR18, if it's physically connected to the router by Ethernet cable or by Wi-Fi. I have it connected by Wi-Fi. On the XR18, as you may or may not know, there are three ways to connect to the XR18. You can directly connect it to a computer with an Ethernet port, with an Ethernet cable, and go straight to the computer or to the router, which is what Michael's asking about. And the second mode is the Wi-Fi client, and that means that I can attach it to a network that already exists. And then the third mode is the access point, where I'm actually using the router that's built into the XR18. In this particular scenario, what I'm doing is the X-Touch is physically connected by Ethernet to the router, okay? And then everybody else are all on that same LAN, that same network that I built, okay? And what's actually kind of fun, I can show you in the software, is that if we look at this page here, I'll take you to the setup page, and here's how I'm connected, okay? And I did set it up here to a local network. Okay, so it's a WPA2 secured network, so I have a password for it so nobody can climb on or anything like that, and I made this network. So it's actually connected right now. It's connected using the Wi-Fi client mode so that I can actually have it just getting instructions back and forth from the X-Touch via the network so that everybody's on the same network. It would be the same network in a real world situation, probably. If you had a router, you would build the same thing in a club. You would have your router and you would create your own network. Probably, you would actually want to do it at home and have them all memorize that network and set them up. And then you would do it in the club. And a quick note on that is, if you're trying to set it up for Wi-Fi client, the XR18, XR12, XR16, you need to be physically connected first with the Ethernet cable to tell it to look for that wireless network. Okay, and then that, because it doesn't understand how to look for it if you haven't told it what to look for, right? So once you tell that with the cable and you assign it and it remembers that network, now you go ahead and you don't need the cable anymore. So best would be to not go to the gig or show not prepared and then have to do that dance unless you have a whole afternoon. But it's like, it would be better. You could set it all up at home and then it's gonna remember it. So when you boot up at the gig, the world is a good place. Okay, so those are the three different ways to connect to it. And in this scenario, this particular scenario, which is what I would do live, is I have everybody is attached to the network that I built here, and then this is connected directly to the router, and this is the master controller for it. So that's how it's connected. The next question is, sends on fader. Yeah, I showed that a little bit earlier, and what's happening here is if I go and look at the modify buttons, okay, these four modify buttons are my sends on fader. Okay, so if we can get the software up at the same time on the screen here, so if I go ahead and I hit this one, this is for my effects sends on fader, and this is for my bus sends on fader. So if I have it here, that's effect one. So if I go to the effect one screen here, this is my sends on fader for my effects. Okay, so, and if I want to do a send for like one of the outputs, so, you know, for my monitor mixes, this is bus 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So right now I'm on bus 1. I go up here to bus 1, and here's my sends on fader for bus 1. So it's just that simple to be able to set up sends on fader. There's not a, if you're used to the X32 or something and you're looking for that button, there's not that button here. It's actually the automation buttons now are your sends on fader, and it's by send. So it's super simple to be able to get to that, okay? And the next question is, can I show how the EQ works with an X-Touch? Yep. And we were talking about that earlier, and I'll be glad to go right back to it. All I want to do is on my top encoder assign buttons is I want to hit the button that says EQ. And if I have the software up at the same time, I want to go ahead and look at the EQ, okay, for channel 1. And then what's happening is that these rotary encoders, I'm going to need that computer screen moved over to the right, please, AJ. There you go. How cool is that? Okay, and then down also, let's cover up the transport. Perfecto, a little bit lower. So what ends up happening is now you can see that I have my EQ for channel 1 is set here. So I can adjust my frequencies here, or my gain is the first one. You see that the scribble strip is split into two. The top is the frequency and the bottom is the gain. So you can see I'm boosting or cutting right here on any of the bands that I want to. Right here, my three or four bands that I have, and this is a high pass, so, or a shelf, a high shelf, so I can do like this. And then, so the way I adjust the gain for each of these, I did the gain first, right? And then if I press and hold the rotary encoder, now I can adjust the frequency. You see it changing from 69 now, and I'm going up, swinging past 100 hertz, and things like that. So that's the frequency, I let go, and now it's the gain, okay? And then it's like if you go, well, that's a really wide berth there. I would never have a bandwidth that wide. I just go to page 2 now, and now I can change the Q. And I can make it a notch filter if I want to. Okay, and I can also change the kind of EQ by pressing and changing. I can make it a, you know, a high cut, high shelf, a vintage EQ, or parametric EQ, however I want to have it. So I want to leave it on VQ, and then I can adjust and notch it right there. So that's how to use the EQ with the X-Touch. And somebody asked if the faders are bidirectional. Yes, they are. If I go ahead and I'm on bus one, or if I'm on my main screen here, and I have it on the main screen on my iPad or my Droid, so if I can get a shot of the Droids and the iPads coming up, and then so if you'll see, like right now I'm moving it and it's moving up and down on the machine, and then it's going here, okay? And also, if I move the fader here, you'll see it's going with everybody. And also, if you get a top shot of the X-Touch again, you'll see that I'm controlling it with the iPad right now, and I can move the faders. So they are bidirectional. So with that being said, is that if you're the artist on stage and you're the drummer, the guitar player, bass player, vocalist, whatever, and you have an assigned bus, yes, those faders will reflect at front of house. But if he's not assigned, like for instance, if you're on bus one, and he or she, the front of house, is on main left and right, it's not going to mess up their faders for the mix, okay? It's just going to change the faders. So if they go to bus one, they'll see what you've done, okay? So it's kind of cool, because if you're in a situation where the person mixing front of house can see that you're struggling with monitors, and they know what you're looking for, they can dial it in the monitors, or you can dial it in yourself, but it's not going to mess up each other as long as you're on different pages. Okay, so yeah, you can control them back and forth that way. Okay, let's see about some other comments. Can I use X-Air like a multi-channel audio interface? Absolutely. You're not going to be using the X-Touch as a multi-channel interface. Just to be clear, this is not a multi-channel interface in as far as recording audio. The X-Air is your I/O, because obviously the X-Touch doesn't have any mic inputs, doesn't have any quarter-inch inputs, so it can't process audio there. But the X-Air, the XR18, XR12, the XR12 and XR16 can record to a USB drive, okay? And it's going to be 44.1 or 48K wave audio that's going to go to them. And it would connect right here, and you'll get a two mix out of your show from there. The XR18, you can see I have the USB port here. So I can connect the USB port to a laptop and be able to get 16 channels of audio bidirectional going back and forth between the XR18 and a DAW. Now, what's hip about the X-Touch is that it does have two USB ports on it, two full-fledged USB ports. So I can actually pass that audio through here if I wanted to. I don't have to directly connect it to the laptop. I could send it through here as a leeway if I needed to for some particular setup. Either way will work, connecting it USB directly to the laptop or connecting it through the X-Touch to the laptop is going to work either way. So yeah, it is a great front end. It has the Midas mic pre's there. It sounds amazing, and the quality is super clean. So what's going to end up happening is you're going to get great recordings. So you can do your show and use it for front of house and take all the channels out to be able to record your whole show. And either do it, you have the choice. You can mix it as a two mix, or you can have all the individual tracks so that later on you can press it and make your record. So it's pretty cool. Live records are always good. So it's great for that. And in the studio, it would work the same way. So it's very hip that way. Let's take a peek at some more questions. On this one, there's a question is, can we control the XR18 wirelessly from the X-Touch, say from the back of the room or from the back of the venue? Right now, it would depend on the size of the venue. You know, if I'm sitting here and they're all on the same network, I should be able to do it. If I want to connect it directly to the X-Air and use the router within the XR, it's going to depend on the room. You know, I'm not going to say that it's going to go a 10,000 seat arena. It's going to be able to reach from the back of the house, okay? But in most typical club setups where you would have 16 inputs or something like that for most club situation, I would probably say you would have to try it and find out if it's going to work. You know, I would do it during setup. And if you start having issues, then you connect it directly with an Ethernet cable, or you can go ahead and get a router. Okay, so I would try you. That's why there's three options on there, because you want to have the best setup for your particular application, right? You don't want to force the hand of one setup versus the other. So I would load in, and I would immediately start finding out the environment that I'm in. You know, if you're in a club in a strip mall, say something. Lots of clubs now are in, you know, their buildings right next to each other in a row on the street. there may be a ton of RF activity going on, so that it would be better to have your own router. But in most cases, if it's just a club at nighttime, it should be fine, you know. But try it. Don't be disappointed after downbeat happens and you're on the gig. You know what I mean? I would try for the best possible solution that's going to make it through your evening. That's what I would give as a piece of advice. All right. So next question. Let's see. Okay, we got another one about the EQ. And okay, the 12, yes, the 12 and the 16 are USB only. As far as the two track with the thumb drive, the XR12 and the XR16 will not multi-track out. They are just to the thumb drive. And what's hip is that the thumb drive is actually dual purpose because it is bi-directional. So you can take a two mix out of your show and do it that way and record it to a thumb drive. What's also nice is if you wanted to load break music on the thumb drive, okay? If in the software, if we take a look at the screen here, up in the Xair edit, I can choose in my preferences and in my audio MIDI right here, I choose the sample rate. Now, if my WAV files are in 44.1 and my setup is 48, obviously it's not going to work. But if you have, like if I had a thumb drive that had 48K WAV files on it of all of my break music, I could use that and all of a sudden I have my break music right with me and I don't have to use two more inputs of my XR just for break music. I can have a thumb drive, drop it in there, pre-format it, whatever I want to do, and have my playback. So that's kind of nice. And you could have different thumb drives and things like that. And the player will show the song names and the whole nine yards. You can fast forward and rewind with the transport. All those things are hip. Okay. Let's see what else we have. What is the max length for youth Wi-Fi control? Again, it's going to depend on the room. You know, I've seen situations where, you know, we're at a trade show and there's so much RF activity going on that everybody's is just failing. And it's the same thing that happens, you know, in any RF situation. I mean, it's like if you go to an NFL game, they have to check channels and they have to check strength before they go to broadcast. It's anytime you have multiple Wi-Fi's going on, you got to make sure that your signal strength is as strong as possible. So I wish I could give you a defined number, but it really is going to do, it's like, how far will my headlights show out in the front of the car? Well, it depends if it's going to be foggy or not or whatever. So it's a variable that you can't really, I'm not trying to tap dance here, but it really does depend on the environment. And that's why I'm suggesting try all three. I would probably suggest walking into the venue and trying the internal router first, okay? And walking around with an iPad and doing that thing and see if you're getting any drops, okay? If the answer is no, rock on and do your gig. If the answer is, yeah, it's a little sluggish or something, then I would go ahead and you can get a dual band 5 gigahertz router really, you know, not that expensively at most, you know, electronic retail stores. So I would go ahead and do that and then just have that router with you. And if you need it, use it. And if you really have to go hardwire between the XR18 and your laptop or the XR18 and the X-Touch, then you could do that as well. Which may be cool, actually, if you're mixing for yourself from the stage. You know, you can just have the X-Touch on the side of the stage over here, you know, and you're playing, you're gigging, and then you just make your adjustments for yourself, for the bands that are mixing themselves from the stage. That might be a cool situation because while it's only a few feet apart, you may want to actually, you know, really make it a tight connection so you can just hardwire it if you wanted to. That's as a suggestion. That's what I would say. Okay. I didn't see a mute for the main bus. Absolutely. Let's take a look up at the page again. And if we go up here, looking over it, if you go over here, this is to choose the bus, and then there's your mute for the main bus is right there, right at the bottom. So these are your mute groups for different channels that you have and individual mutes and solos that you can control from the XR18. And on the actual X-Touch itself, you're correct, there's not a mute button for the XR18 or the X-Touch out of the control, but you do have one in the software, so you would still be able to get there through your iPad or through your device and be able to mute it that way if you wanted to. So yeah, there's in the software, there's a mute for the left and right two mix on the way out. On the actual X-Touch, there's not a simple button for that. Good call. How does X-Touch work with Reaper? With other kinds of DAWs, it's a good question. It depends. We adhere to Mackie Control and Huey formats and how they all dial in and work and how they spec out and how they control DAW. So we're going to the sources for that. How it controls other software, how the X-Touch controls other software programs is going to be predicated on how that software adheres to the Mackie Control or the Huey protocol. Okay, and I have not personally tried it with Reaper, but I've tried it with Traction because Traction is great software and it comes free with your purchase. You download it from Behringer.com or you download it when you do your registration. I've tried it with that. I've tried it with Logic and I've tried it with Pro Tools and Cubase, and they all respond a little differently based on how they adhere to MIDI protocol, okay, or Mackie Control protocol or Huey protocol. Okay, so if you're using it and you're not getting a ton of functionality out of it, you know, and it says that it has a Mackie control mode or it says that it has a Huey control, I would probably hit up their product support, because it's not that there's anything wrong with their software or anything wrong with the X-Touch. It's just that they need to communicate a little bit better. And the manufacturers are usually really awesome at kind of going, yeah, got it. I've seen this before. This is what you do. Okay, so I haven't used it with Reaper, but if it falls under Mackie control or falls under Huey, it should work just fine. Okay, let's see. There's a question here from Abe Ray. Does the transport control work with thumb drive? And the answer for that is yes. You can do rewind, you can do fast forward, all those things like that using it with it. And there's also a control in the actual software screen as well for to be able to use the tracks. So as soon as you actually put in a music thing and there's on the screen for the XR12, there's a true track player, and it comes up just like the X32. It's a big cassette deck, which is awesome. It's a cassette tape with the transport underneath it, and you'll see the song names on the left and be able to control the transport there. So it works really cool. And Bradley asked, does the X-Touch Compact and Mini work with the X-Air in a similar way? At this point, it is solely just the X-Touch. Okay, the Compact and the Mini, okay, I haven't actually seen any configurations for them as of yet. I'm sure that they're working on it feverishly, but at this point, this release, this 1.15 release is for the X-Touch, okay? So I can't speak for the other two at this time, but stay tuned. All right, if you wanted to actually just control it, period, for MIDI volumes and things like that, you can connect MIDI cables to it. You know, you have two MIDI, you have MIDI in and a MIDI out on here, and you would be able, and on the back of the units and on the front of the other two units, you can use the MIDI in and out to be able to control simple things like volume and things of that nature, mutes and things. Okay. Yeah, okay, yes. Abe had a good point for everybody here, and it's really cool. You can assign your main outs to a mute group. Okay, and then you could indeed control that from here if you wanted to from the X-Touch. So that's a good call, Abe. Thanks. All right. So cool. So I'm seeing that it's kind of slowing down on the question flow, but I still invite more questions if you want. We have a video that's coming out that kind of does an overview as well of this, and if you have any particulars, please don't forget that we have an awesome forum that we answer all kinds of questions there every day, and so if you want to continue the conversation after this broadcast is over, the forum will be a great place to do that, and we'll get all your questions dialed in there as well. So this is kind of the basic overview of how cool the X-Touch works with the XR products, with the X-Air, with the XR12, XR16, XR18. It's an amazing amount of control to be able to have to make your workflow, whether it's live or in the studio, as simple and as effective as possible so that you can stay being creative and stay in the love zone and keep making music and not be buried in the tech. That's the whole idea of this, is to make it simple so that you stay creative. And if you're a pure engineer and not an artist, it makes your workflow simple so that you can handle anything that gets thrown at you on the fly, and it's gonna work great. Okay, so this is the overview for these things. Of course, for more questions and media and videos of that thing, you know, you can come visit us at Behringer.com. Thanks for joining us here at Music Studios.
Whether it's string sections or punk rock or you name it, so having a personal monitor system really helps out when, you know, I can just be sending the signals out and then letting the artists all dial in their own mixes. It saves me a headache, and then once people get the process down, it really lets them just create their own comfort zone. So we've had our P16s about a month. They're getting rave reviews, both from the engineering side and the artist side. They sound clean. There's more features on them than I really expected. And so it gives a lot of flexibility as far as however involved you want to be with dialing in your own mix during tracking. So they've been great. So on a day-to-day basis, our mission can be very different. A lot of people hear that Red Bull has a recording studio and they picture a voiceover booth for TV commercials or something. While we do voiceovers occasionally, it's a music studio. So we always are working with very different types and talent, different levels of people as far as where they are at in their career. But a personal monitoring system like the P16 is something that pretty much everyone's going to be really hands-on with and be using anytime we're tracking here. So, a situation where these really get used would be, say, you're tracking a live 4 or 5-piece band. We could set a collection of these up out in our tracking room. Everybody can have their own mixer. A lot of times in the old days of studios, the drummer and the bass player might have to share a mix, and the bass players keep saying, "Why is your kick drum so loud?" And the drummer's saying something about, "I still can't hear the vocal." You got these, everybody can just really be in their own headspace, in their own world. They're not interfering with anyone else, and once they get the hang of it, they can just kind of go as deep down the rabbit hole as they want, as far as these have the EQ, a bit of limiting, so they're really flexible. This is Eric from Rebel Studios saying thanks to Behringer for stopping by.
Y'all want to hear one more? Let's just let these cats play a little bit. I'm going to get out of the way. I'm talking about. Everybody give a big round of applause. Doug Wimbish, Eric Gales, and the Bugera booth. Thank you, fellas. All right. These guys will be here. Eric will be here. You want to take pictures, sign things, everything like that. He's going to be around. Doug will be around. Thank you very much for coming to the Bugera booth. Y'all want to hear one more? Let's just let these cats play a little bit. I'm going to get out of the way.